This is a Formula One pit stop in real time. Within just 2.5 seconds, all four tires are changed and even the car's setup was modified. And to understand how that is possible, I've animated the entire thing so we can take a look at it in slow motion. The first factor determining the speed of the stop is how well the driver manages getting into the pits. Every pit lane has a strict speed limit. On tracks with particularly tight or short layouts, like Monaco, the speed is capped at 60 km an hour. But on most circuits, it's 80, or about 50 mph. In order to lose little time, the driver tries to brake as late as possible when entering the pit lane. Once past this line, the driver presses a dedicated button on the steering wheel that locks the car to the speed limit. Next, the driver turns into the box and has to place the car as precise as possible, as the entire pit crew is positioned with pinpoint accuracy. If the driver overshoots even slightly, the whole team has to adjust, stepping forward to compensate and wasting valuable time. To help the driver nail their mark, teams use a mechanical arm with an arrow in the pit box, and the perfect stop happens when the front tires line up exactly beneath that arrow. One of the boldest roles in the pit crew belongs to the front jack operator. This person stands directly in front of the car, positioning the front jack so that it catches just a bit of momentum from the nose cone as the car comes to a halt. Then, in one smooth motion, the operator lifts the car from the front. At the same time, behind the car, the rear jack operator gets into position. Since they need to leave room for the car to enter, they're slightly slower than the front jack, but the moment the car stops, they also slide a jack into place, lifting the back wheels. Meanwhile, on either side of the car, two stabilizers step in. Their job is to absorb the sudden jolts from lifting, making sure it's perfectly aligned for the stop. For changing the actual tires, the wheel change crew consists of 12 people, 3 for each tire. At the center of each team is the person holding the wheel gun. Even before the car stops, this person is tracking its movement, aligning themselves so they can instantly lock onto the wheel nut and apply torque the moment they get a chance. Unlike regular car wheels, which are typically fastened with 5 bolts, an F1 tire is secured with just one single lug nut, precision manufactured with multiple pawls that the wheel gun can lock onto. The wheel guns themselves are custom made for this purpose and require immense strength to operate. That is because they can spin at up to 15,000 RPM, enough force to rip it right out of your hands if you aren't ready for it. Since a couple of years, the front of each wheel gun features an LED ring that shows the real-time status to the operator. The exact color coding varies from team to team, but in our example, the gun initially glows white, indicating that it is in loosening mode. As soon as the tire is loose and the gunman releases the trigger, the wheel gun then automatically switches its mode. The LED changes from white to blue, and the gun has entered its tightening mode, meaning the next time the trigger is pulled, it will spin in the opposite direction. As this is happening, the person in front of the tire quickly moves it aside, and in perfect synchronization, the person behind is bringing the fresh tire into position, so that the wheel gun operator can begin tightening it. The wheel gun automatically detects when the wheel is fully secured, and the LED ring now lights up green. As soon as that happens, the gunman presses a button on the gun, sending an electronic confirmation that their task is complete. While all of this is unfolding, the front jack operator has already stepped aside to clear the space for the car's release. The jack is designed to keep the car lifted up while it swivels out of place. And once they're in a safe position, the jack operator presses a button on the jack to confirm they're also ready. Each of these button presses serves one purpose: to ensure that every key function signals when they're done. The driver, in the meantime, isn't watching the crew. They are focused on a traffic light in front of them, and until every single crew member has pressed their button, it will remain red. Because while the front tires are done, the rears still need to be secured. These often take slightly longer to finish, simply because the rear jack lifts the car a fraction of a second later than the front jack. And on top of that, the rear tires are larger and heavier than the front ones, making them a bit trickier to handle. Sometimes, a driver will have radioed in a message that they'd like their front wing to be adjusted during the stop. If that is the case, two mechanics step in from the front of the car, each carrying a pre-programmed torque driver. They insert it into designated holes on the front wing, and the torque driver rotates a screw by a precise number of turns, adjusting the angle of the front wing, which changes the car's aerodynamics. Just as these adjustments are done, the rear tires are also secured. All four gunmen have signaled they're done, and the front jack operator has given the all clear. But for safety reasons, the light doesn't switch to green automatically. Instead, the crew chief, who oversees everything, provides the final confirmation. Only when all has gone to plan, and when the pit lane is clear with no other cars blocking the exit, does the crew chief press the button. The front jack drops the car, the light turns green, and the car takes off. All that in just 2.5 seconds. In Formula One, clear communication can make or break a race. And the same is also true in aviation. And what happens when communication goes bad is what I explore in my full-length video about the Tenerife disaster. The video tells the story of how in 1977, two Boeing 747s collided with each other on a runway. It is, to this day, the worst accident in aviation history, and it was one of my most ambitious videos I ever worked on. This video is part of my documentary series Under Exposure, a series where I bring fascinating stories to light that I believe deserve to be told. For example, I made a video about two East German families that fled their country with nothing but a homemade hot air balloon, attempting the daring escape of flying over the heavily guarded border at night. And for this video, I even got to interview one of the people involved. The reason I was able to make all these videos is because I joined forces with a bunch of other creators. And together, we are building Nebula. The idea is pretty simple. Since Nebula is not an ad-driven platform like YouTube, but a subscription model, we get to create higher budget productions. And besides my own series, we also have game shows, incredible documentaries, short films, and even full-length feature films. Plus, I always post my videos there early, so you can already watch my next upload there today. So go to nebula.tv/neo and make sure to use exactly this link in order to get 40% of the annual plan. So thanks for the support, and thank you so much for watching this video.